Hey everyone, and welcome back. Today we are diving deep into Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
Oh, yeah.
And this one, it's like everywhere you turn, right?
Right.
So it's more than just another book. It's practically a cultural phenomena.
It really is.
And we've definitely given our listeners quite the reading assignment this time around. But that's what we do here.
That's right.
We take these big, sometimes complicated ideas and break them down
Yeah.
so you can actually use them, make them work for you.
Absolutely. And this book, let me tell you, it's packed with those big ideas. One of the things that I find so fascinating about Robert Kiyosaki's approach is how he uses his own life, growing up with those two father figures, right? His own dad and then his friend's dad, the rich dad, to really kind of challenge the way most of us think about money.
It's almost like we're getting a front row seat to his own financial education here.
Yeah, exactly.
So for those who maybe haven't cracked the spine on this one yet, what's the core message Kiyosaki really wants to get across? Like, what's the big takeaway?
He really boils it down to this. It's not about how much you make, it's about what you do with it. And he constantly hammers home this point about assets and liabilities, which he says most people, they just get it totally wrong.
Okay, so let's break that down a bit.
Yeah.
Because I think when a lot of us hear the word asset, we think, okay, that's a good thing. Like, I want more assets,
Right.
right? So where does the confusion come in?
Well, you see, Kiyosaki argues that most people, they mistake liabilities for assets all the time. And, the classic example he uses is a house. Most people think, oh, my house, that's my biggest asset. But Kiyosaki's saying, no, if you're living in it, it's a liability. It's taking money out of your pocket.
Hold on. Now, how can my house be a liability? I mean, it's probably worth way more now than when I bought it, right?
See, and that's the trap, right? Because even though it might appreciate in value over time, it's also constantly draining your account. You've got your mortgage payments, property taxes, insurance, maintenance, on and on and on.
It never ends.
It never ends. So Kiyosaki, he says a true asset, it puts money in your pocket. A liability takes it out. Big difference.
Okay, so that's a pretty big shift in perspective for most people, I think.
Absolutely. But he also points to rental properties, right, as like a prime example of an asset. Because even if you have a mortgage on that property, if the rent you're collecting is covering your expenses and putting money back in your pocket, that's an asset working for you.
So it's all about that cash flow.
Exactly.
Where's the money going? And this
Exactly.
kind of ties into that other big theme he talks about, the rat race.
Yes.
This idea that people work, they get raises,
Right.
but that they just end up spending more.
That's
They
right.
upgrade their lifestyle, bigger house, maybe a fancy car, and
Yeah.
they think, well, this is what I'm supposed to do, right?
Exactly. They think that's what you do with more income. But all they're really doing is staying on this treadmill. They're not getting ahead financially.
It's so easy to get caught up in that, though, right?
It is.
You see everyone else kind of upgrading their lifestyle, and you think,
Yeah.
well, I deserve that too.
Absolutely. And Kiyosaki, he uses this great example, right, of the expensive car to really illustrate this. People, they buy into this image of wealth instead of focusing on actually building wealth. So Rich Dad, Poor Dad is really urging us to break free from that mindset. Focus on growing your asset column first, things that generate income, and then you worry about those luxuries.
So it sounds like it takes a lot of discipline to break out of that rat race,
It
right? Like
does.
to really shift your thinking.
Yeah, it
Does
does.
Kiyosaki offer any strategies for how to do that? Like, what does he see as the key?
He's a huge, huge advocate for financial education. He's not just saying go buy real estate or go invest in the stock market. He's saying you have to understand how money works, like on a fundamental level.
So it's not enough to just get a good job.
Right.
You need to understand how to manage your money, how to invest it wisely, build that asset column we were talking about. You've really got to take ownership of your own financial literacy.
Exactly. And, he's big on seeking out knowledge everywhere. It's not just about like formal education. He's encouraging people to read books, go to seminars, learn from mentors, whatever it takes to kind of expand your financial knowledge.
I like that. Speaking of learning, he also has some interesting things to say about corporations, right? And how they fit into all of this. He seems to suggest that they play by like a different set of rules when it comes to finances.
Yeah, and he points out that they have certain advantages that individuals don't, especially when it comes to taxes, right? They can write off expenses that, the average person just can't.
So is he saying then that the system is kind of rigged against the average person?
I don't think he necessarily frames it as right or wrong,
okay,
but he's definitely emphasizing that it's important to understand how these structures work if you want to build wealth.
Okay.
Like, it's about being aware of how the game is played.
Knowledge is power.
Right, exactly.
He doesn't just complain about the system. He's saying, okay, here are the rules. Now learn them and use them to your advantage.
Exactly.
And I love that he actually created that board game, Cash Flow.
Yes.
To help people learn these concepts in a fun, interactive way.
It's brilliant.
It's not just about reading a textbook.
Yeah.
It's about finding ways to make financial education engaging.
I agree. And that's what's so unique about his approach.
Yeah.
You know, he wants to make this accessible to everyone.
Yeah.
And another way he does that is by addressing this emotional side of money, too.
Oh, okay.
Particularly the fear and doubt that holds a lot of people back. He calls it the Chicken Little syndrome.
Oh, yeah. The sky is falling.
Exactly.
Which can definitely keep people from taking risks and exploring opportunities.
Exactly. And he says so many people, they're just so afraid of losing money.
Right.
That they stick with what's comfortable, even if it means staying in a job they hate.
Yeah, you're safe, but
they're so focused on avoiding the toilets, as he calls them,
yeah,
that they miss out on building real wealth. But even wealthy people, they feel fear too.
Right.
It's about acknowledging those fears.
But not letting them control your decisions.
Exactly.
And that's where mentors come in, right?
Absolutely.
Having people who've walked the path.
Yeah.
To offer guidance and support.
Absolutely. He talks about how both of his dads, in different ways, were mentors to him, right?
Right, shaping his views on money and success.
Yeah, but he's also very clear that it's not about just copying someone else.
Right, this isn't a one-size-fits-all approach.
Exactly.
It's about finding your own path, what works for you.
Right, what resonates with you.
It's about identifying your strengths, your passions.
Yeah.
And using those to create a life that's uniquely yours.
Right.
Life of financial freedom and fulfillment.
Yeah.
And that really resonated with me because, you know, when I first read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, it was like this light bulb moment for me.
Oh, really?
It made me realize how much my own upbringing had shaped my views on money, even if I didn't realize it at the time, you know?
It's true, though.
Yeah.
Our families, they play such a huge role
yeah.
in shaping our beliefs about money, our habits.
Totally.
Often subconsciously, right?
Yeah, totally. Like, did your family emphasize saving for a rainy day,
mm-hmm.
living right. within your means, that kind of thing?
Yeah, definitely. How about you?
Oh, absolutely. My parents were all about financial security.
Okay.
Which, you know, isn't a bad thing.
Right, of course not.
But reading Kiyosaki's book, it kind of opened my eyes to these other approaches.
Yeah.
These other ways to think about building wealth that I'd never even considered before.
And that's the thing about financial education, right?
Yeah.
It's all about expanding your awareness.
Right.
Challenging those assumptions that we've picked up along the way.
Yeah.
And ultimately, it's about giving you the power to make decisions that truly align with your goals, not just the ones you've inherited, you know?
So for those of us who maybe didn't have a rich dad figure in our lives,
yeah.
what are some practical first steps we can take,
yeah.
you know, to kind of boost our financial IQ?
Mm.
Where do we even begin?
You know, one thing that Kiyosaki emphasizes over and over again is finding mentors.
Okay.
People who are already doing what you aspire to do.
Yeah.
And of course, never stop learning, right?
Right. Try.
He's all about reading books, going to seminars, you know.
Yeah, constantly soaking up knowledge.
Constantly soaking it up, yeah.
He even suggests, like, taking a second job.
Yeah.
And not even just for the extra cash.
Right.
He sees it as an opportunity to learn new skills, gain experience that could be valuable later on.
Exactly. It's all about adopting that entrepreneurial mindset, right?
Yeah.
Always be looking for ways to expand your skill set, you know.
Don't be afraid to roll up your sleeves and get your hands dirty.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And he would know.
Right.
I mean, remember, he started out with small ventures, mm-hmm. like collecting and selling comic books.
It's about seeing those experiences as investments in yourself.
Absolutely.
Not just a temporary grind.
Exactly.
And you just touched on something really important, too, with that entrepreneurial mindset.
Yeah.
It seems like that's a big part of what Rich Dad, Poor Dad is all about, right?
It really is.
It's not just about managing your money. It's about finding ways to make your money work for you.
Exactly. And that often means breaking free from that traditional mentality, you know.
Go to school, get a good job, retire at 65.
Exactly. Exactly.
I'll be challenging that.
He's saying there are alternative paths to financial freedom.
Right.
Like starting your own business.
Okay.
Or investing in assets that generate passive income.
So you're not always trading time for money.
Exactly.
It's about taking control, designing a life that really aligns with your values
yes.
and your aspirations.
Absolutely.
And sometimes that means taking risks.
Yes.
Which can be scary, right?
It can.
But he's saying that playing it too safe.
Yeah.
That can be just as risky in the long run.
That's a good point. You could miss out on opportunities.
Right.
Live your life in a constant state of what if, you know?
It's all about balance, right?
It is.
Cautious, but bold.
Yeah.
You know, calculated, but open to new things.
Yeah.
You mentioned passive income, and I feel like for a lot of people, that sounds like a dream come true.
It does.
What are some examples of that?
Well, you know, rental properties are the classic example.
Okay.
You're generating income without actively having to trade your time for it.
Right.
But it could also be things like dividends from stocks.
Okay.
Royalties from a book you've written.
Right.
Or even income from an online business.
So it's about setting up these systems that kind of work for you.
Exactly. So they continue generating income even when you're not actively working on them.
Okay. So now I got to ask about something that comes up a lot when we talk about building wealth. Taxes.
Yeah.
Kiyosaki, he definitely doesn't shy away from this topic.
No, he doesn't.
In fact, he kind of challenges some of the traditional thinking around taxes.
He does.
Especially this idea that, you know, the rich should pay more.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's a point that definitely sparks a lot of debate.
Yeah, it does.
But it's still important to understand where he's coming from.
Right.
Even if you don't agree with everything he says.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So he argues that, you know, wealthy people, they often use corporations and other legal structures to minimize their tax burden, right?
Right.
But he's not saying that they're being greedy or trying to cheat the system.
It's about strategy.
Right. He's saying they're playing the game strategically, using the rules to their advantage.
Exactly.
And he's not necessarily saying that everyone should do that.
Right.
But his point is, you need to understand how the system works.
You got to know the rules.
The advantages, the disadvantages, so you can make informed decisions.
Yeah, it's about empowering yourself with knowledge.
Yes.
Not just complaining or, you know, being envious of those who seem to be benefiting.
Right. It goes back to that knowledge is power.
Exactly.
And this is where that whole concept of financial IQ comes into play.
Yes. And he breaks that down.
Which he breaks down even further.
He does. Into four key components.
Right. Understanding accounting.
Yep.
Investing, markets, and the law.
It's about seeing the big picture.
It's not just about being good at math or crunching numbers.
It's much bigger than that.
It's about understanding how money works in the world.
Exactly.
And he also stresses that this isn't like a one and done thing.
Right. It's not like school.
Yeah. It's not like you learn it once and you're good.
Right. You have to keep learning.
It's a lifelong pursuit.
Lifelong. Yeah. Because things are constantly changing.
And, you know, one thing that I really appreciate about Kiyosaki's philosophy is that it's not just about accumulating wealth for yourself.
Right. It's not just about you.
It's also about giving back.
Absolutely.
Using your resources to make a difference.
He really learned that from his rich dad, you know?
Yeah.
The more you give, the more you receive.
Yeah, it's about creating that cycle of abundance.
Exactly. Not just focusing on your own little pile.
Right, having a positive impact on the world around you.
Absolutely.
Like that saying, the more you share, the more you have.
I love that.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not just about getting rich. It's about getting rich and making a difference.
Exactly.
And that kind of brings us back to, I think, one of his most important messages, right?
Yeah.
This whole idea of finding your path.
Yeah.
He talks about how both of his dads, in a way, served as mentors to him.
Right.
You know, shaping his views on success and all that.
Right. But he makes it clear.
But he also makes it clear it's not about just copying someone else.
Exactly.
Like this isn't a one size fits all approach.
Right. You have to find what really speaks to you. What's your definition of success?
Yeah. What are your passions? What are you good at? It's about using all of that.
Exactly.
To design a life that really feels authentic to you.
It's about taking control, right?
Yeah, taking control.
And designing a life that really reflects who you are, like deep down.
And that might mean, you know, going against the grain a little bit, challenging those expectations that society kind of throws at us.
Absolutely.
You know, go to school, get a good job, retire at 65. Kiyosaki's saying, hey, maybe there's another way.
Exactly. Question everything. Really think about what you want your life to look like.
Right. Because you have the power to define success on your own terms.
Absolutely.
I mean, he even talks about how he left a secure job.
He did.
To pursue his own ventures, which, talk about a bold move.
It was risky.
Especially considering how much his family emphasized job security and all that.
Exactly. But it allowed him to kind of break free from that mold.
Yeah.
Create a life where he wasn't just trading time for money.
Right. And ultimately, I think that's what rich dad, poor dad is all about, right?
It really is.
Achieving that financial freedom so you have the flexibility to pursue those passions.
Absolutely.
And speaking of passions, You know, one thing that Kiyosaki talks about too is the importance of giving back.
Yes.
He says he learned from his rich dad that generosity has a way of, coming back around.
It's true. Like that old saying, the more you share, the more you have.
Right. So it's about embracing that mindset of abundance.
Exactly.
It's not just about amassing wealth for yourself, it's about leveraging that wealth to make a difference, right?
Make a positive impact on the world around you.
Yeah. And that could look like so many different things.
It could.
Mentoring others, sharing your knowledge, supporting causes you believe in.
It's about recognizing that true wealth, it goes way beyond just your bank account.
It really does.
Yeah.
You know, at the end of the book, Kiyosaki leaves readers with a really powerful question.
Oh, yeah.
And this one really stuck with me.
What was it?
He asks, "How has your thinking about money been shaped by your upbringing and your experiences?"
Oh, that's a good one.
Right.
Yeah.
And how might you start shifting your thinking to create a different financial future?
He's really challenging us to take a look in the mirror, isn't he?
It's a call to action. It's like, okay, you've read the book, now what are you going to do about it?
Exactly. It's time to stop just thinking about it and
Yeah.
actually start making changes.
Because reading a book is just the first step.
Right. It's about taking
Yeah.
action.
Making those real, tangible changes in your life.
Rich Dad, Poor Dad. It's a reminder that we are not stuck.
We have choices.
We have the power to create the future that we want.
To take control of our financial destinies. Well, on that note, I think we've reached the end of our deep dive into Rich Dad, Poor Dad. Hopefully, this conversation has sparked some new insights for you,
I hope so.
challenged some assumptions,
Definitely.
and maybe even inspired you to redefine what financial freedom means for you.
It's been a pleasure exploring these ideas with you.
Likewise. And to everyone listening, remember, it's never too late to start.
Never too late.
Thanks for joining us on the deep dive. Until next time, keep those minds curious and those goals ambitious.